card. Yeah, you just brought up a point that's very interesting. Helping others that is not to your detriment. How do you find that balance? Because some people can get lost in helping others too. That is an escape. So, well, if you took the shamanic journey and you were trained by mentors, I mean, that's part of the journey too. How to self-care and then not deplete your energies and help others. Because I find that that calling that you have, that you had to help others. I mean, this is it, isn't it? It's this calling to help others.
It's self-respect, Michelle, and I think when you, so you can't give from a, is my cup. You can't give from a cup that's empty, and you can't give from a cup that's half full. So you have to honor and respect the sovereignty within you, and that doesn't mean you're better than anyone. So the ninth principle of shamanism reminds us that we're here to be of service. The eighth principle reminds us that all things are sacred. So you kind of have to have that understanding that, well, you matter too. And if you're not in a position to give from a place of abundance, well, then what can you give? How effective can you be? So you have to look after yourself. You really, really do.
And how do you do that? How do you personally do that?
It took me a long time to figure this out, but what I do is I have a daily ritual which involves meditation. It involves being grateful, sipping from my copper chalice, and so just being grounded, Michelle, and not losing sight of the perspective. It's knowing that if you get really close, you'll see the ocean erode the shore away, because that's nature. And then knowing that if you get that far back, it all looks really beautiful. So it's about maintaining the perspective and being grounded in your truth, not somebody else's truth. That's the key. It's knowing who you are at a soul level, because that's who you actually are. You're a soul, an eternal being, can't come here to manif to incarnate in this human experience and to manifest great things. Like, we didn't come here to live a life of lack. We didn't come here to struggle. That's the system, the programming that's been thrust upon us. That's the thing we've been born into. You go to a, like, I remember you go to, say, the island of Bali, and you go up into the highlands, and you know what? They're the happiest people I've ever met, because they don't have TVs. They don't need anything. Everything they have is what they have, and they're grateful, and life's just beautiful. They grow their own food. It's community. So, we're thrust into this world that tells us that we need all these things, and all this stuff. Happiness is external to us, but fulfillment, peace, contentment are the greatest things you can ever acquire on this journey. And when you come from that place, it's really easy to be grounded.
Yeah, there's a something I heard, I don't know who said it, but it was about like the thing about manifesting and the beauty about manifesting is that you can manifest everything you've ever wanted, get the house, whatever, the relationship, the money, da da da. And then once you get everything, you realize, okay, that's not it. So that's the beauty of it, that some people can actually, some people need to take that journey. I never did, but it is part of some people's journey to they are master manifestors, but then only once they have everything, they realize, oh, I still don't have anything. And so that is, the shift from the external to the internal.
This manifestation thing at the moment is really topical, and there's all these there's so many experts on manifestation, and there's so many philosophies and ideas around what that really is. But the shamanic view on manifesting is, open your eyes, look around, that's what you've manifest. So everything in your reality, well, you can't blame anybody else. You have to take responsibility for where you are, because you have the third principle reminds us that energy flows where attention goes.
Yeah.
So you have to say, well, I've nurtured this reality around me by focusing my energy into it.
I've heard that saying for many years, you know, energy flows where attention goes, but I didn't realize it was from a shamanic principle. So true.
It so is. And, you know, the one thing about the shamanic path, which a lot of people don't appreciate, is that you are asked to take responsibility.
Yeah.
There's no deflection. There's no blame. There's no God's testing me. There's none of that. It's like, no, this is your path. You're responsible, and you better sort it out, because no one else will or can.
Yeah.
And that's, people don't like that stuff. And, you know, I sugarcoat it as best I can. And I'm as gentle as I can be with the people I work with. And you know, they get it. We navigate through that stuff, and they come out the other side powerfully.
Yeah. I think that what people don't understand is that what you're saying, and what we're saying by talking about personal responsibility, is that you're that powerful.
Correct.
You know, so
correct.
It's about empowering others. And when, even when people contact me for energy readings and energy sessions and soul guide, whatever, even bioenergy healing that I do, I have them sign a form saying that they are still responsible for their own physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being. That because, and I've had people contact me and then I never hear from them again once I mention this thing that I want them to sign. And I thought that's why I do it, because those who don't want to take responsibility then will not be a good match for my sessions. And
that's really important, Michèle. And that is, you know, to all the other people that are watching out there who are working with people one-on-one, you have a responsibility to protecting yourself from people who may not necessarily be the best fit for you. And that's wisdom, Michèle. And what I do is I interview everybody that potentially wants to work with me.
Right.
And, you know, within 15 minutes, I know, within 5 minutes, I usually know where they're at. And because I don't want to waste their time or money, and I certainly don't want to waste my time.
Yeah.
And so if I don't feel that they're going to be ready for the commitment, then I say, look, you know what? I gently explain that to them and say, you know, come back to me in 6 months, or maybe I'm not your guy. Maybe you need someone who'll tell you what you want to hear, not what you need to hear.
That's really, really good.